Hello, dear chess friends. I'm Grandmaster Petar Arnaudov. And in today's video, I will explain you some of the most important principles in the endgame rook against pawns. This lecture is a warm-up for the upcoming workshop practical rook endgames. You still have time to sign up for the workshop at www.modernchess.com. What can I say about the endgames rook against pawns? So they arise quite often in my opinion, and also many rook endgames sometimes end up in an endgame rook against pawn. Those endgames usually require a lot of calculation, and each tempo is quite important. Although in this lecture I will try to explain you the main ideas, but not I will not force you to learn some long lines and to remember some long variations. I will try to explain you the principles how to play those positions and to show you the basics. So this is, I think, the most basic position in the endgame, rook against pawn. It's white to move. If you want, you can stop the video, you can pause the video and try to guess what's the winning move for white. Okay, I will start. There's only one winning move, and it's the move rook f5. So white is cutting black's king from the fifth rank, and then black's king cannot support the pawn. This is a technique which you need to remember, and this idea is quite important. So how we win now? If black just stay, then white's king is coming closer to the pawn, and just take it. We have all the time in the world to do this. If black decide to push the pawn on the fourth rank, then we still come with the king. And when black's pawn reach third rank, we're attacking the pawn. The king is unable to defend it, so black need to move it. And then after rook e3, we win the pawn. There's one more technique. When the pawn reach the second rank, we play rook on the first rank. King b5, rook e1, and the pawn is lost. Let's continue with the next position, which is a little bit more complicated. It's black to move in this position. So, what do you think, guys? What is the best move for black here? Again, you can pause the video and try. Hello? Okay, let's continue. First, I need to say that this position is a theoretical draw. But even some very strong players made a mistake here by playing the natural move a2. This is actually a losing mistake. Because after rook b8, black's king is forced to go to a3. And then after king c2, black cannot promote queen, because then after rook a8, the queen is lost. So black should promote the knight, and after king c3, we reach a theoretical position where the knight is poorly placed on the corner and white wins. For more details about this endgame, you can check the video by Grandmaster Grigor Grigorov in our YouTube channel. So, let's go back to the starting position and see how black should continue. The only move which saves the game is king b2. Because now, after this check, black is playing king c1, so we're not going in front of the pawn. Now the threat is a2 a1, so probably white needs to stop a2 and then king b2 back. And there's no way for white to make a progress here. The position is just a draw. Let's continue with the third basic position. It's this one with the B pawn, so with the knight pawn. It's white to move. The king is close, but nevertheless, this is a draw. Why is that? So, like threatening B1 queen, the only logical move seems to be rook h2 check. Then king c1, and after king c3, black is promoting a knight, not a queen, a check. And then after king d3, black is the only move at his disposal, but it's enough to keep the half point. Knight a3, and after rook a3, it's important that the knight is not going to b5, but it's going back. So this is just a draw, guys, believe me, you can check. We continue with the fourth basic position, which everyone should know. How to fight against two connected passed pawns. So here the rule is very simple. If the two connected passed pawns reach 6th rank or 3rd rank, respectively, then they are unstoppable and they cannot be stopped. Then white, the side with the rook almost always loses. There are some mating motifs sometimes which can save the game, but this is the general rule. If the pawns already are on the 6th rank, it's lost. So we need to stop this. And the principle here is very simple. We should go behind or in front, it doesn't really matter, the most advanced pawn. So in this case, this is H pawn. That's why white needs to play the move. Rook to h5. And then black cannot move the pawns, because if h2, then rook takes h2. If g3, then rook takes h3. So the only logical attempt is to come with the king. Then rook h4, so we're taking one of the pawns. Again, probably the best try is to play h2 to keep the g pawn alive. And after rook h2, king e6, probably you remember the first basic position? Yeah, you're right. We're cutting the king on the 5th rank, so rook to h5, king f6, just king b7, and the position is lost. Okay, guys, this was like an introduction so far. So let's continue with some more complicated examples. This is an example which I like a lot. It's white to move. What to do? So black is threatening to play king c4, later b3, king c3, king c2. So white's king seems to be far. Again, pause the video and try to find the only winning move for white. Okay. Then let's see. The only winning move in this position is king b7. You will say, wow, why is that? Why the king is not going forward? You will see why. This is a reciprocal zugzwang, when black king is forced to leave the opposition, allowing white to come forward. So we will see several attempts, let's say king a4 and king c4. After the move, king c4, We're playing king b6. Or king a6. b3. King a5. So, king c3. King a4. b2. King a3. And we're just in time to collect the pawn. The same thing happened after king a4. This time king b6, king a4, king b6, b3, and this time king c5, so from the other side. King e3, king c4, b2, king c3. Of course, king c5 is not helping at all, because after king a6, we're just coming and taking the pawn. Let's see how white can go wrong in the starting position. White can try king d6, which looks very logical, but actually this move is missing the win. Now, king c4. Black's king is stopping his colleague to come closer to the pawn, so white cannot play king d5, king c5. And after king e5, b3, king e4, king c3, white is unable to stop black's king to go to c2 and then b2 and draw. After rook c1, the rule here is that we should never go in front of the pawn. So, king d3, king c5, b3, king b4, b2, rook somewhere, king c2, and we achieve the position which we already know at knight. So, this idea, let's say after king d6, to play king c4, is called shouldering in the chess literature. So, by his shoulders, black's king is stopping his colleague to come closer to the pawn. This is a principle which also you need to remember. Let's continue with the next example. It's the same position like before. I'll flip the board for you. But it's black to move. So, in this position, if it's white to move, we know what's the best move. It's the move king b7. So what to do now, guys? Again, please pause the video for a second and try to guess what's the only move which saves the game for black. Yeah. The right move here is king c5, taking the opposition, and this is shouldering again. So now after king b7, we are playing king b5, not allowing king a6 or king c6. King a7, yeah, you're right, king a5. If white decides to wait and play king rook b2, then king a4 is already making a draw, because after king b6, king a3, black win an important tempo. Rook b1, b3, and this is just a draw. Can continue, say b2. King c4, king a2, white is one tempo short. So, guys, remember this idea, opposition, shouldering. This can save you a lot of points. Okay, another example. Let's flip the board. Oops, let's make it like that. Black wants to promote his pawn. It's white to move. What to do? I'll give you a few seconds to think. Let's see. The right move here, and the right approach, is to attack the pawn from behind. How we're doing this? The only move is the move rook g5. It seems a little bit paradoxical move, but that we have all these squares at our disposal. Otherwise, we cannot go on the d5 because the king is on the way. So let's see the main lines. After king d3, we're using another endgame technique in this type of endgame, the intermediate check. So rook d5 is the move which wins the game. This move wins an important tempo, because we already know that if the king comes in front of the pawn, this is bad. Then black needs to move the king again, so he will lose another tempo, so we just come with the king and take the pawn. Very easy, I'll show you just in case. Let's say e3 and king d5, and the position is dead lost, because after king c7, we give this check. Black needs to come here in order to defend the pawn, and then rook f3, just finish the game immediately. So, after rook g5, king f3. Oh, sorry, I didn't finish this line. Rook d5, king c2, rook e5. And black is forced to come here, so white won an important tempo. The rook comes behind the pawn. And then we have a choice between king d5 and king f5. Always the opposite side. King f5, no shouldering. King f4, e2, king f3, and black resigns. It's the same after king e2 here. Yeah, we saw this. And after king f3, we have this rook f5. The same thing. This check is very typical. It's something you need just to know by heart. It's win decisive tempo for the stronger side. So the same variation, just a mirror line like before. Okay, we continue with some harder examples, in my opinion. So white wants to promote the pawn. It is white to move in this position. What to do? The position, unfortunately for white, is lost. If g5, then we're using the standard method to cut the king on the fifth rank, this time on the fourth rank, rook c4, with a well-known winning position. So, if king f4, then black wins using the same technique as before. Rook g2, the rook is coming behind the pawn. This is the only way to the victory. g5, king f2, black needs to support the pawn, king f5. And then, not king f3, but king g3. Remember, guys, we need to go on the opposite side. So he is going on the f-file, we're going on the h-file. g6, king h4, king f6, king h5, g7, king h6. With the winning position. Let's move on. This time, it's black to move. Let's flip the board again. Black wants to promote the pawn. How to continue here? You have a choice between several tempting moves. The position is equal, but black needs to play the only move here. So please again, pause the video and check if you already remember something from the previous examples. The correct approach here is again shouldering. In such situation, the weaker side can save the game by pushing away the opponent's king. The right move is king c4, not allowing white's king to come closer. For example, if king d4, then king b4 is winning. If e3, then king b4 is winning. King is coming. So king c4. There are two ways for white to fight here. One is rook h3. Now king d4. e3. There is no check from behind. So white is forced to lose tempo. Then just e2, rook e8, king d3. And this is a draw. If rook e8 now, after king c4. So Rook e8, King d3, King b4, e3, King b3. So again, one other trick. After Rook d8, of course, we are playing King c2, not King e2. And after King b3, we are playing e2. So he cannot stop King d2 and e1 queen. Let's continue. This time, it's white to move. And white is winning, but how? So, let's see, guys, if you remember something. Very well, I think many of you guess it. We're using the same technique. Like we saw in one of the previous examples, we're giving an intermediate check. So, Rook f7 check. King, if king goes to g3, we'll see what happens. Let's see first if king goes to e3. Then we attack the pawn. So he's forced to go to f4. Now we want a tempo. And then king f7, g4, king g6, g3, king h5. Well-known idea. Already saw. So if king g3, then king e7, then g4, and then king e6. Very important move. Why is that? If we play the natural king f6, this allows king f4 shouldering, and after king g6, king e3 with the draw. So with the move king e6, we are stopping king f4. Black's king is forced to go to the h-file, and then king f5, g3, king g4, g2, check, and there is no other files, so black is forced to go in front of his pawn, and this is easily winning. Just to know, the last trick could be rook f2 mistake, and after king h1, rook g2, this is just a draw. So the winning move is just rook f8, giving a tempo, king h1, and after check, king g1, rook h2, the pawn is lost, and there is no drawish motives. If in the starting position, we start with the move, rook g7, instead of rook f7 check, just g4, king f7, g3, and we can easily see that white's king is far away, and this is just a draw. Yes, we are going to some harder examples, in my opinion. This is a very interesting position. So, this is a game, Diaz against Dominguez. And I will show you how Diaz failed to win this. It's black to move. Black tried the move king e4, of course, the most logical one. And here in the game, Diaz went wrong. So please pause the video and try to find the correct solution. So this time the rook is in front, not behind. Okay. The move Diaz played in the game is king d6, f5, threatening f4, f3, rook e2, and then shouldering again, so where we go? Correct. King d4. Black king cannot come, and after rook e2, f4, f3 is coming with tempo, which is very important, and this. So, what's the winning move? Rook e2 intermediate check. And then after king f3, he's playing rook e1. White's playing rook e1, f5, king d6. After f4, white is playing king e5, king f2, rook e1, f3, king f4, and now it's obvious that black is lost. Why is that? Because after king g2, rook a2, f2, we have king e3, and white is just in time to collect the pawn. So, instead of king f3 after rook e2 check, black can try king d5, shouldering again. And then we're using this well-known technique, and the main point of white's previous move is to provoke this king d5 and king on the d5, and after rook f2, black's king is forced to go to e5. After king e5, we come closer with the king, king c7, f5, king e7, f4. Now, guys, I offer you to pause the video and try to find the winning move for white. The only winning move in this position is rook to f1. Let's see what's wrong with the move king f7. It looks very logical, but it's actually losing because after king e4, king f6, black is gaining an important tempo attacking the rook. And then after rook f1, f3, king f5, king e2, black wins. Black saves the game. So, let's return to rook f1. The idea of this move is that now, first, black will break the opposition, and also the rook is far, so black cannot win tempo by attacking it. So, king f5, king f7. This time, we're forcing black to break the opposition. So, if king g4, king e6, if king e4, king g6. The idea which you already saw in the previous examples, I will not continue here, but let's say we can make a few moves just to illustrate, you know, that black is one tempo short. Let's continue with the next example. Rook against a rook pawn. This example is very important for the theory, for the endgame theory, and for especially for the theory of the endgame's rook against pawns. It's very simple. It's a drawish position. After rook e2, we are not going to the first rank. We already saw this because king g3 and h1 knight. King f3 is winning, so we need to go to h3, and after rook e1 to go back to g2. Very simple, just to illustrate. Yes. The second example is this one, which, in my opinion, is very, very important. So, guys, pause the video and try to find the only move which saves the game for black. Black is trying to promote the pawn. But what to do? If you start by pushing the pawn, probably for the 10th time I will repeat you this idea, cutting the king the 5th rank. So, if king b5, which looks like the most logical move, and probably many of us will play this without knowing anything about this position, then after king f7, a5, king e6, king c4 trying to shoulder us, rook e8, force black's king back to the b-file. King d5, f4, king d4, king b3, king d3, a3, check. The position is lost, because after king k2 we have king c2, and after king k2 we have king c2 again. Rook e8, king b3, a2, rook h8, followed by mate on the next move. So a5 is losing, king b5 is losing. Then what, guys? King c5, thinking about shouldering. King f7, a5, king e6, a4, so now king d5 is not possible. he can try the same idea, rook a8, but then king b4, king d5, a3, king d4, king b3. And this is the position which we already know. This is our basic position, not a2, guys, but king b2, followed by king c1 with a draw. So instead of rook a8, he can try king e5, a3, rook a8, king b4, king d4, king b3, king d3, king b2, king c1 with a draw. Okay, very well. Let's continue. Let's first start with the examples where rook is playing against two isolated pawns. Yeah, against two isolated pawns, they are less dangerous than connected pawns. But of course, if they reach the penultimate rank, there's always some chances for black, for the weaker side to save the game. So here we need to play the move rook to h8. The best possible place for the rook is on the first rank. We need to improve the position of the rook. So king f2, and then rook h2 check. So of course we're not allowing black to promote his pawn. If king e3, then there is rook h1, king d3, rook e1, and on the next move we're taking one of the pawns and then the second one. So king f1, rook h1 check, we're coming on the first rank with tempo. If king d2, then king d2, this is just winning, because our next move is rook e1, rook takes e2, rook e1 back. And if king g2, rook e1, king f2, king d2. Let's imagine this. Now we first take this one, then come back, take the second one. So the rook is better placed on the first rank. Let's see one example when the rook cannot be placed on the first rank and the rook is placed behind the pawns. So black wants to promote the pawns. Rook c8, what else? If rook a8 or something, just king b2. If king e2, of course, this is stalemate. So rook c8 is a decent try. King b2, king d2. It looks like that we are going to take the pawn. That's true, but we need to give the rook for it, because there is this drawing technique. E1 queen, or any other piece, basically. And after king e1, c1, c1, black survived. Okay, now let's see several examples with rook against two connected pawns. The pawns become dangerous, especially when they are so close to promotion square. And usually the stronger side need to unite effort of king and rook for oppose them successfully. Where is the best place for the rook? Behind the pawn or on the first rank? The answer to this question is quite vital for the evaluation of this position. So guys, please pause the video and try to find the best move for white, and also try to evaluate the position. White is winning, black is winning, this is a draw. Those of you who think that white is winning are correct. The best move is rook b1. The rook is perfectly placed on the first rank. So just I want to mention that the pawns are e and d, because other rules applied for different pawns. King f3, king d3, king f2. We need to wait again, so we give black the move. if this, then we just play rook d2 and we're winning. If king f3, then we give this check. King is going somewhere, doesn't matter where. And after king e2, we block the pawn. Our next move is rook d1, then king e3, and it's over. So, or our next move can be king e3, because the king needs to move from g2. So let's see different situation where white's let's see this position where a white's rook is placed behind the pawns. This is a worse place for the rook than on the first rank, and here black is able to survive. Doesn't matter which move is it. After rook e7, black has at his disposal the move king c2. So if black try rook a7, this is even losing. Because so if white try rook a7, this is even losing because e1 queen take d2 and d1 queen. If king e1, d2 is winning, of course. So rook d7, trying to stop d2, but then king d2 back. He wants to promote the pawn, rook e7, king c2 back, and this is a draw again. Okay, so f4. Guys, let's return to the positions with a rook against two connected pawns. In this position, rook is properly placed on the first rank, or so on the eighth rank, and this is supposed to be winning. But you need to remember that with the knight and bishop pawns, or the rooks and knight pawns, so if the pawns are on the C and B file, or in F and G file, or B and A file, the position is actually a draw. And white can save the game using a stalemate motif. So this is already a bit advanced technique, and king b5 is the right move. Rook h8, black is trying the same method. King a6. Now if king c8, there's a strong move king a7. And if rook g8 just stay, then the move which makes a draw is king a8. Because king a6 is losing due to rook g1. So king a8, king d7, king b7, rook h8, king a6. Let's see what will happen if after king a6, black plays king c6. King a7 and waiting move, rook g8. If rook c8, then b7 is a draw using this stalemate motif. So rook g8, and then c8 queen, forcing the rook to go to c8, b7, rook c7, king a8, rook takes b7, stalemate. This time, the rook is again on the first rank, but the pawns are too advanced. So white is actually fighting to save the game. Move like rook to e8 immediately loses because of g2, f2, and black wins. Move like king d2 is losing because of king d4, an important move. Rook a1, g2, rook a4, king a5, Rook g4, f2. So what to do, guys, in the starting position? Rook f1, attacking the pawn. If f2, then after king e2, rook takes f2, this is a draw at least. After g2, we have king e1, take, take, and we transpose to a drawish pawn endgame. After king e4, we play king e1. After g2, we have king f2, and again we transpose to a drawish pawn endgame. So king e3 looks dangerous. And then there are two ways to make a draw, you need to remember them both. One is rook takes f3, the simplest. King takes f3, king f1. With the drawn pawn endgame. And the second one is rook f2 here. If g takes f2, king f1 is a draw. And if g2, then rook e2 is drawn again. Is drawn again, because after king f4, we just take the pawn. Okay, guys, so let's go to this example. Again, two pawns on the third rank. But white is able to save the game. What to do? First, come closer with the king. Now we'll examine both moves. We'll start with d2, d2 and e2. Then king f3, king d3, rook to first rank, e2, check, here, check, king c1, check. If king b2, we just take on e2. If, this is just a draw. And if e2 first, attacking the rook, looks very dangerous. But rook c1, check. If king b3, we have king d3, d2, rook b1, check, and then collect the pawn. If king d5 here, then we have king f3, d3, and an impressive move here, rook c5 check, removing the rook from c1, and then king e2 with the draw. So if after rook c1 he played king d4, we play king f3, d2, the same idea, rook c4 check, but this time black is not forced to take the pawn, so king d3. And now we use the same idea again. Rook d4, sacrificing a rook. King takes d4. King e2. King c3. King d1. This is a basic king and pawn endgame, which is strong. Another typical defensive idea in fight against connected passed pawns is to use a stalemate possibility. It's white to move, so white needs to play king e1. Black has two ways to try to win the game. One is king c3. Then, after king d1, b2, we're losing. But after king rook e3 check, king c2, rook e2 check, king c1, rook e3, black cannot advance the pawns. So after c3, we have king d1. After c2, we are taking and use this defensive method, transposing to a drawn pawn endgame. But after b2, we have the stalemate idea. Rook d2, he cannot take because it's a stalemate. And after king c4, we play rook takes b2. C takes b2, king c2, transposing to a drawish king and pawn endgame. And in this position, again the pawns are advanced. One is on the second rank, the other is on the third rank. So it seems that he is playing king d2 and win. What to do? Pause the video, guys, and try to solve this alone. See, remember this idea, the defense on the third rank, the third rank defense, or the sixth rank defense, respectively. Rook e3. So, what is so good about this move? King d2, then we have rook d3 check. If the king comes in front of the pawn, we just take, and we're out of danger. If the king goes to c2, we continue giving checks, so rook c3. King is going to b2, try to escape on the a-file. Rook b3. And now if king a2, we have rook a3. King b1, because if king a1, king d3, white can even win. So king b1, and rook b3 check again, transposing to which we already saw. So king a1, rook e3 check, king b2, rook b3 check, king c1, rook c3 check. This is a draw, guys. The famous third rank defense. One other idea, this position, is again to use the third rank defense in a little bit different occasion. King c5, so let's flip the board, it will be probably easier for you black ones to promote the pawn. So king c5. So after e2, there's a defensive method which saves the game, and this is the check on the third rank. This is the point of the previous move. So now king is coming on the second rank, and we take the pawn and then take the other pawn with the draw. If king d2, then king d4, again this draw. If king d3, then king d5, again this draw, because d3, we have the same trick. Rook d3, rook f3, check. So, after king c5, the best try is probably king b3, trying to go far from the pawns. And then, the natural looking moves like king d4 are just losing because e2, rook f3 check, king b4. So he's not forced to go to the second rank. After king b5, he has king c2, and then king c4, king d1, and e2 is coming, so black is winning. After rook f4, he has e2, rook f3, king k4, rook f4, king b3, not king k5, because after rook f2 here, white will even win. So king b3, f3. This is also a draw. So king b3, rook f3 check. Rook f3, sorry, it's not a check. King c2, again king k4. King c4 is even winning for white, because white is threatening king e2, king d3, king e2, and then if e2, rook f2, using this mating idea. So king c2 is a good try, but then king d4, e2 is not possible because rook f2, king d2, king e4, e2 is forced now, rook f2, king d1, with a draw. Guys, I think that I managed to show you most of the positions which I consider absolutely basic and which you should know about this endgame. Of course, there are many more, and if you're interested in this endgame, you can examine different examples. I will put some test positions in the PGN, which all of you will receive after the camp, practical rook end games. So for those who attend the camp, you will receive a PGN, detailedly commented PGN, with all the examples from this lecture. I think there are about 23 examples, which I managed to show you. For those who think that I talk a little bit fast, and go very quickly through the examples, the PGN file will be extremely helpful, but also you can just play the video again. I hope the lecture was useful for you and that you enjoyed. And see you soon, guys. All the best, and I'm looking forward to see you all of you on our camps. Have a good day.